It's officially game four of the 2020 Eastern Conference Finals, with the New York Knicks holding a commanding 3-0 lead over the Boston Celtics. And this team is on the verge of going to the finals for its first time in 20 seasons. Right after a game led by Julius Randle, where he had 115 points, the highest point total in NBA history. But Boston's trying not to give up just yet. Jason Tatum in the corner shoots it right over Rudy Gay. And now with 10.5 seconds left on the game clock, Rudy Gay goes to pass it in, but it deflects off of him, and it's Boston's ball, down by two with 10 seconds left to go. And now Boston's going to pass it in here to Kemba Walker, trying to get something to go over Frank Ntilikina, New York's premier defender. And well, he does, off of the Enes Kanter screen, hits a three-point shot. 4 seconds left on the game clock, and the Knicks are down by 1 point. And you already know who the ball is going to. Right side, post up on Gordon Hayward, Julius Randle spin move to the basket. And to cap off the greatest series of his life and maybe a lot of other people's lives, Julius Randle with the game-winning shot, the game-winning dunk, that is. And the New York Knicks are heading to the NBA Finals for the first time since 1999, where there was a lineup that really wasn't expected to go to the finals, kind of like this one. Charlie Ward, Allen Houston, Latrell Sprewell, as well as Larry Johnson, and of course the legend himself, Patrick Ewing, rounding out the five. So hopefully this team will be able to do something similar to that. Now, going into the NBA Finals, well, who are we going to be playing against, you're probably asking? The Los Angeles Clippers, the first seed, the best team in the NBA, have advanced to the NBA Finals. So that's our opponent. And well, this is obviously the team I did not want to play. They had 64 wins on the season, and their lineup is composed of Patrick Beverley, Paul George, Kawhi Leonard, Jamichael Green, Montrezl Harrell, Lou Williams, Avicii Zubac, Deion Waiters, Landry Shamet, Derek Jones Jr., Rodney Magruder, and that's basically it. But I don't need to go too in-depth on this lineup because I already spent the whole last episode talking about him, but yeah, you kind of get the gist of it. Now, my game plan going into this game is kind of just going with the flow and doing what we have been doing throughout this whole playoff run. We've already made one of the most historic playoff runs in a long time for this franchise, so let's get straight into it. At this point, heading into game one against the Clippers, I'm just shook seeing even any type of NBA Finals logo with us in the first season. I still don't know how we made it this far. I tried to make the slider so games were tougher and all that stuff, and we could still go out and drop 115 points with Julius Randle on the team because they don't have good defenders. But anyways, now we're here, and well, the first play I was kind of detached and didn't realize we were here just yet. He's like, I was shook. I was like, how are we going to score on this Clippers team? I probably had a couple open shots I could have taken, but Paul George, he's not getting any of those open shots, and he keeps missing contested ones. Now, I wanted to go check out the rebounding advantage we have. Now, Mitchell Robinson, he's 7-1, and Montrezl Harrell is 6-8, and his rebounding stats are considerably better. So we're definitely going to take advantage of that throughout the series for sure. And then, well, where they have their advantage is the defensive end. Both Paul George and Kawhi Leonard have defensive stopper and pick dodger Hall of Fame, which is just insane. So it's kind of crazy, but their quote-unquote weak link in the series when it comes to the defensive purposes is actually Patrick Beverley. And, like, he's Patrick Beverley. He's one of the better defensive players in the league. He'd most certainly be the best defensive player on our team, but obviously since, you know, we have the RJ Barrett height advantage at that point guard position, he's a desirable destination to get the ball to. And well, right here, Ntilikina playing good defense once again on Paul George, even though I'm jumping for joy, but eventually the Clippers are going to get their first points of the game with him just shooting the layup up and over Ntilikina. So as of right now, we have a lot of free throw points, but aside from that, we get our bucket here with RJ Barrett on that Patrick Beverley matchup, which I'm saying like is a mismatch, but it's really not, honestly. Kawhi Leonard, there we go. He does his Kawhi thing, hitting a three off the screen. And well, Julius Randle, it's going to be tougher for him to get into a game like this when the Clippers are just so good at defense, regardless if it's the guy that's actually on him, Jamichael Green, who actually isn't the greatest defender, but their help defense is crazy. So as I watch Mitchell Robinson just grab his own rebound and dunk it over Zubac, because why wouldn't he? It's a very Mitchell Robinson type of play. Ntilikina on the break here, I maybe would have shot that in other situations, but my God, Julius Randle. Now, maybe he'll have a disadvantage in the half-court setting with the Clippers' defense being so good, but in the open floor, he's still going to dunk over people like always. Now, here's a prime example of the Clippers being the Clippers, and well, Paul George pull up on the fast break, three-point shot off the Kawhi Leonard steal. It's this is why they're in the finals. So we're quickly losing the lead that we had, which wasn't really that crazy in the first place. Right here, you see the rebounding is just crazy. Even though we couldn't actually make a shot there, just seeing how many rebounds we got over this team shows that we'll have a pretty solid advantage through the series. And well, Paul George here on the left wing, and just what the hell happened right here? Just watch. Just keep watching. I'm going to keep talking because I'm trying to keep the voice in here because I don't know what the hell to say at this point. He just bullied Neal Aquino like he was his child. Now RJ Barrett going to the basket here, and Julius Randle sets up a nice play for him. And Kevin Knox, now, first of all, post situation is really weird for Kevin Knox, but he got open and still missed. But I want to just pinpoint that Kevin Knox, I said he was the best player off the bench for us, and then like the past like 6 weeks, he's made like 3 shots total. And well, Taj Gibson, the greatest post player of all time, there he goes right there. And once again, my God, now Timmy G himself is dominating already in this game. Well, there goes washed up Terrence Ross, also known as Deion Waiters, hitting the, or airballing three, I should say. There goes Kevin Knox's 4th shot in the past 6 weeks. And well, Lou Williams, I was kind of scared for his matchup on Dennis Smith Jr. because, you know, Dennis Smith Jr. isn't the greatest defender, but he did pretty okay, you know. Now, there goes washed up Terrence Ross doing moves that only, well, not even Terrence Ross or washed up Terrence Ross should be able to do. Dennis Smith Jr. gets fouled here, and this is like a new incredible discovery we found, that he can actually make free throws, which he hasn't made one in like literally, I don't think I've made one to him, I'm not even exaggerating, in months, like since the beginning of the season. There goes Taj Gibson again, and Terrence Ross goes to the basket and completely bullies Zubac like he's the center, and goes to the basket, gets the N1. Gibson again here in the post, my God, goes around Kawhi Leonard. Now, I was reluctant to even do that because, you know, he's Kawhi Leonard, but we had no time left on the shot clock, and well, it works somehow, but, well, I guess because Taj Gibson is the greatest player in the world, and now Mitchell Robinson may forget he exists, so he just dunks it down. Deion Waiters, I don't know, man. I expected to get cooked by Paul George, not Deion Waiters. Now, Kawhi hits a very Kawhi shot. That's why this team's in the finals. And, well, RJ Barrett, I throw away a stupid pass here, but then the most cheesy thing I've done in, like, months here, I get a bump steal and then throw a lob to Mitchell Robinson, which, I mean, it's impressive, but I feel, like, ashamed that I did that because, you know, I didn't even feel as ashamed dropping 100 points because all I did was spin moves in the post. And, well, at halftime, up by 6 points, and this is the most disgusting play we'll see the whole series. Oh boy, he's hurt again. Mitchell Robinson is down. Again. He hurt his elbow. He's so hurt that he was proposing on one knee and now he's down on the ground like his knees are broken when really it's just his elbow. But we just lost Mitchell Robinson. Again. When I was just talking about how much of an advantage he gives us, we lost one of our only advantages as Patrick Beverly hits a weirdly contested three. Thankfully, RJ on the other end, though, somehow takes advantage of a Patrick Beverly matchup like I was implying. And, well, oh God, Mitch, please come back. I can't see Montrezl Harrell 6'8 self making layups like that over Luke Cornett for the rest of the series. All right, Julius Randle hits a three. I decided to check in with Mitchell Robinson because, you know, he's kind of like a pretty important piece and I want to see how he's doing after a few possessions. And, well, yep, he's out. 67 overall, minus 10 points, and he's out. I say that because, well, you're not going to see any of those miraculous type of things like the other game when he came back and I didn't even expect it, but Fizdale just kind of put him back in. Nah, he didn't come back in this game. That was it for him. Now, Paul George in the post here once again, and, well, Luke Cornett, what the hell? Well, since when are you good at defense? All right. Terrence Ross, right corner, mid-range shot, and he hits that. So we have an 8-point lead right now, and Luke Cornett, are you Blake Griffin? Well, actually, Blake Griffin doesn't even really dunk anymore, but are you prime Blake Griffin? Because I don't know, man. Now, Mitch Robinson, we finally get his injury report here. He's day-to-day again, which, like, is very deceiving because then maybe he'll be, like, a 68 overall for 7 years. But Taj Gibson, mid-range shot. And back to the Mitch Robinson thing, it's just kind of sad because, like, it's one of our only advantages in this series and one of the things that was helping us win this game up until this point, including that guy, Taj Gibson. But all of a sudden now we lose him for maybe even next game. Well, actually, I'll assure you, yeah, he's going to be up the next game too, even though I didn't play it yet. But Dennis Smith Jr. now, even though Lou Williams wasn't cooking him, he was cooking Lou Williams. Now, if you didn't realize, I put Dennis Smith Jr. back like permanently in the rotation, not just like as like a guy who gets some minutes here and there. And well, he proved some stuff to me in this game. He's playing pretty well so far. He actually hit a free throw, so that's cool. Terrence Ross to the basket here. Third quarter clock winding down. Kawhi Leonard taking up the ball. Throws it up to Deion Waiters. And like I said, I thought I was going to get the production or see production from Paul George, not Deion Waiters. Now, Kawhi, sure, he's going to get his buckets too. It's not going to be all Deion Waiters saving the day. But Terrence Ross, now, These are the type of buckets I needed from Terrence Ross for, like, weeks when, well, at least during these playoffs when, like, you know, we're, like, in close games and we're getting open shots and just missing them. So shout out to Terrence Ross for actually making the tough shots, or actually not-so-tough shots. RJ Barrett, green light in the corner right here. And, well, Paul George, he's also open now. I don't know what to do about Paul George taking really stupid shots, because I have the CPU's offensive and defensive awareness on 100, because I want them to be smart. So I don't know. There's nothing for me to do with him taking stupid pull-up shots. But anyways, Julius Randle here, take the continuation N1, even though it's not even in the NBA anymore, but it's still in 2K. That's cool. Patrick Beverley pulling up like he's Chris Paul. And will RJ Barrett going to the basket here, playing an incredible two-man game with Julius Randle. Randle comes down to the paint, out to RJ Barrett for the mid-range shot in the corner, similar to the one Terrence Ross took earlier. And Neal Aquina always finds ways to get himself involved offensively, regardless of however the hell it is. And now Kawhi Leonard, he's just going to Kawhi Leonard his way into being effective. And Julius Randle, there's the Julius Randle we know and love. Now, I know he has like 20 points in the game, but he's just not as dominant in this game. We've shot a lot of shots. Kawhi, that shot can easily go in for him, but thankfully he misses. And Randle, once again, going to the basket. They remembered that he dropped like 115 points last game, so they double-team him. And Rudy Gay, green light. 92-84 lead right now. RJ Barrett behind the back, spin move, jump shot. And we have a 10-point lead with 2:20 left to go into the game. Oh, yeah, by the way, Fizdale subbed in Chuma Okeke, and that kind of cost me this dunk right here because I wasn't controlling Rudy Gay. But I don't know why the hell he subbed. Well, actually, I do know, because Mitchell Robinson's dead, and we need to give his minutes to somebody. And, well, Julius Randle here, he gets double-teamed, and eventually we kind of just get clamped up by the Clippers completely, get a shot clock violation. So 1:10 left in the game. 6-point lead in our favor, and Terrence Ross in the post on Kawhi Leonard, and he blocks away Kawhi's shot. He says it won't be that easy. And now a good two-way game here. Rudy Gay to the basket. Of course, we missed the shot. But Kawhi Leonard out on the break here. He's dribbling up. He's going to pass it over to Patrick Beverley in the paint, who I played horrible defense on myself personally. And, well, for some reason, JaMychal Green, just like his controller died, and eventually, Rudy Gay wide open. Terrence Ross in the paint and one dunk. And, well, did Julius Randle just jump over him? What the hell? All right, man, I'm seeing way too much in this game that I didn't think would come this early in the series. Well, Kawhi Leonard, there he is being Kawhi again, but it seems like it'll be a little bit of too little too late here. And, well, Kawhi dribbling up just kind of throws it to Julius Randle. And we actually won. I can't believe I'm saying this. I still can't believe we were in the finals, but we won a finals game against the best team in the league. We avenged the 99 Knicks, who didn't win one game in the finals, even though they were the first 8 seed to make the finals. And, well, and that's really all I've got. Drop a like if you're ready for game 2 at the Staples Center, where hopefully we can continue this momentum. That's all I can really hope for at this point. I don't know if the Clippers are going to go God mode like how I thought they would in game 1. And instead, we took our momentum from that incredible Celtics series, and we beat them by 8 points. Drop a like if you're ready for game 2, and I'm out. Cut.